what I'm going to start with tonight is reading the first entry I made in a journal that I kept when I was on the expedition playing Silas Goodrich. I started with them up in Elk Point, South Dakota. I relieved another guy who was playing Silas Goodrich. He'd been with them for a month. During the entire Lewis and Clark expeditions, there were 270 reenactors during the 2.5 year, 8,000-mile journey. And the reenactors tried to do the same thing every day that Lewis and Clark did. And they followed the journals. They read the journals. And if Lewis and Clark stopped somewhere to camp, they would stop somewhere to camp. So at the end of my first day with my character, Silas Goodrich, I said, I want to go home. And I'm going to elaborate on that pretty soon as to why I wanted to go home. But for right now, I'm going to say a few words about Duane Knott. Now, Duane and I wrote a play about Lewis and Clark that we performed during the Kansas City Film Festival, the Fringe Festival. And we played that for 4 nights. Duane is an unbelievable writer, a tremendous director, and a producer. However, I'm going to let you be the judge as to how good he is as a captain on the 340 race that Scott Mansker originated 9 years ago. We had a boat about a 20-foot outboard with a cabin on it, and it was called the Grim Reaper. That was very appropriate in our case. Duane was the captain, so he got to drive all the time, and Larry Shepard, who was in the boat, was keeping a log of, are we on time with the demands of Scott? We're supposed to be in a certain spot at a certain time, and Shepard was always worried that we might not be there. And so my job in that 340 race was to sit in a lawn chair in the back of the boat and watch the banks to see if any of the 280 racers had gotten in trouble. Like they could have gone behind a big brush pile and turned over, they could have gone down the wrong channel and thought they were in the mainstream of the Missouri River. And I would say things when I saw them over there like, are you okay? And then they would wave and I would wave. And that was my job, except for drinking coffee. I drank lots and lots of coffee. So it kept me wired to really do my job properly. At one point, after about 5 or 6 hours into the trip, we're following all these canoe and kayak people. Everything's going well. Duane's getting bored, but he doesn't want anybody else to drive the boat. So he peels in behind a big rock wing dock where there's a lot of pretty deep water, and he cuts the steering wheel to the right, and he rams open the throttle, and we go, yeah, in a circle. Instantly, there are hundreds of Asian carp in the air, big, silver, flopping carp. And we get about 10 of them in the boat, and they're all back there with me, and they're flopping around, and I've got a 15-pounder in my lap. And I can't get rid of him because they're so slick. You can't pick them up. They slide right out of your hand. And so once I got rid of them, I had this slime all over me, and it smelled like 10-day-old socks. And so that's it for the report on Duane at that point. So you can be the judge as to how things go. But what he did that was really fabulous is he got us 340 miles. To St. Louis. I got interested in Lewis and Clark and Cow Point Park because I read a blurb in the Kansas City Star that they needed people to help clean up the park because the reenactors were going to be there at the same time the original Lewis and Clark people were, which was June 26, 1804, to the 29th. And in fact, Cow Point Park is where Lewis and Clark stayed for the longest period of time, except for winter headquarters in Mandan and out on the Pacific Ocean in Oregon at Fort Calthrop. I go down to the park one Saturday morning. I'm the first one there, because I'm always the first one there. And it is a humongous trash heap. It's like a miniature Deffenbaugh dump. It has car bodies and old refrigerators and televisions. It even has a dead dog in it. And it has thousands of tin cans and balls. And it has two sunken barges at the confluence, Kaw River and the Missouri River. Those things have to be cut up. And we're like into the fall, and all this stuff has to be done by the time that the reenactors arrive. Amazingly, we get all that stuff cleaned up. The reenactors come, they stay 3 days, they do the same kind of stuff that Lewis and Clark did, like there was a court-martial, the first one west of the Mississippi, and that was because Collins and Hall, two privates, got drunk and went to sleep on guard duty, so Collins got 100 lashes and Hall got 50 lashes. That would be with a leather whip on bare backs, and it would be that way and that way 100 times. So their backs are bleeding, and Clark makes them get in the keelboat and start paddling upstream, and the flies are swarming their bloody backs. This was kind of a rugged deal. You would think these guys would have learned from when they got in trouble back in St. Louis, when they stayed at Du Bois, a fort they built across the river from St. Louis. They got court-martialed there also, and they got lashes there, you know, but they didn't learn. So anyway, at the time that the reenactors were there, someone said, we need a Silas Goodrich at Elk Point, South Dakota, to relieve another guy. And if you want to come up there and be that person, you can do that. You have to make sure that you pass some tests, like you have to be able to swim and think halfway straight, and you have to sign all these papers that you're not going to sue anybody if you do something awful. So I go there, and I drive past where Floyd died. Sergeant Floyd died in Sioux Falls, Iowa. He died from an appendicitis attack. He was the only casualty of 40 men that were on the expedition. I stopped at Floyd's grave on the way and walked up there, and it was sad. Guy was 22 years old. Everybody loved Floyd, and he spent 2 days with a burst appendix laying in the bottom of the keelboat. And on his last day, when Lewis was kneeling down beside him, he looked up at him and said, I'm going away, and he died. It was an extremely sad situation, of course. So I go from Sergeant Floyd's grave up to Elk Point, South Dakota. And I get there at dinner time, and they're having deer stew, because we have pretty much the kind of food that Lewis and Clark ate. And I hate deer stew so bad, because growing up in the Ozarks, we had deer every week, and I got to where I hated it. I hated to smell it cooking. But I ate the deer stew, and about 10 o'clock at night, this is on my first day, I crawl up on the second tier of the keelboat, and lay down to go to sleep. And I had brought DEET with me because I knew the mosquitoes would be bad. And you weren't supposed to be bringing modern conveniences, but I didn't want to suffer that much. And the mosquitoes ate the DEET like it was chocolate cake. I'm off of the second layer, and I go down to the main part of the boat, and they put a tarp over the front of it at night. There's room for 8 people to sleep under that tarp. There is a humongous storm coming. Lots of lightning, lots of thunder, lots of rain. There's black flies underneath that tarp by the hundreds. And they don't bite quite like mosquitoes. They have their own individual bite. They ran me out of there within 10 minutes. I get out into the encampment. There's 5 tents out there where the rest of the men are sleeping. I crawl into one tent, and they're snoring so bad, I can't possibly sleep. So I lay there, and I'm already starting to think, if I went home, would they miss me? About 4 in the morning, somebody, I don't know how they found me, but the guard that I relieved at 4 in the morning came and got me. And now I'm walking around in the encampment, and it's raining so bad and lightning. But every night on the real Lewis and Clark expedition, there would be guards that stayed up all night. So at dawn, the cook crawls out of his tent, and he starts making the most powerful boiled coffee that I've ever drank, and it got me back awake. Mid-morning, we all get dressed up in our uniforms and march for a mile, these are wool, a mile in 100-degree heat, and we're going to the induction of Patrick Gass. He's taking Sergeant Floyd's place, sir. We have to stand at attention for like an hour and a half in the blazing sun in these horrible wool outfits. And I'm thinking, who is going to faint first? I hope it's not me. We get through that. I mean, there was endless speakers. There were Native American speakers and other speakers with Lewis and Clark. So we get through that. And I think things are going to get a little better, surely, because they can't get any worse. And there's a fishing contest for kids. And since I'm the expert fisherman, I get to judge the fishing contest. And that was the highlight by far of anything that had happened at that point. So it got a little better each day after that. But it never got really, really good because it was too miserable. I mean, the mosquitoes didn't go away, and black flies didn't go away, and the storms didn't go away. Now, Lewis and Clark, when they came from St. Louis on May 14, 1804, and made it to Kaw Point, they almost destroyed all of their boats, the keelboat and the pirogues, the 2 40-foot rowboat type boats that were with them because of snags in the river. And it rained so much that everything got wet. And the only reason why some of the precious stuff didn't get wet is because of Thomas Jefferson, 3rd President of the United States, and Lewis lived together for a year in the White House with 12 servants and planned this expedition after Thomas Jefferson got $2,500 from Congress to make the exploration. So it took them 3 days to repair all this stuff. That's why they were there for so long. And I got to take a shot of this whiskey because the Lewis and Clark guys got 4 drams of whiskey at the end of every day. Yep, that's what it tastes like. So these guys from the start got beat up every day. My God, how they got beat up. and they made 10 to 12 miles a day up the Missouri River, and that's paddling and poling and people out on the bank pulling the keelboat. This keelboat is huge. It's 55 foot long, it's 8 foot wide, and it has 10 tons of cargo, plus the men that are on the boat that are getting it up the river. So they average that kind of mileage every day. The pirogues were mostly manned by French engagees. So there were 40 men starting out from St. Louis. What Jefferson thought and Clark and Lewis thought initially was they're going to make this trip in a year. It took 2.5 years and 8,000 miles. And once they got past what is now Mandan, North Dakota, nobody ever heard from them again in the civilized world for another year and a half. So they just figured they were all dead, as you might think. When they got to Mandan, their winter headquarters, they had gone 1,600 miles, paddling, poling, fighting a 4 or 5 mile an hour current. And Mandan is where they're going to stay for the winter. It was a bad winter. It got down to 40 below zero. They didn't have much insulated underwear back there. It was horribly, horribly cold. And Lewis, since he had gone to Philadelphia to learn how to be a medical man and to learn celestial navigation and biology and zoology and all the things that he needed to know to be in charge of this trip, he was the medicine man for the Native Americans in Mandan, and so they would all come to him for treatment. And since it was so cold, like one lady brought her child to him, and he had frostbitten toes, so he cut his toes off. But, I mean, he had to do that. And when he went to Philadelphia to train to get ready for this trip, he studied with a guy named Benjamin Rush. Benjamin Rush was a co-signer of the Declaration of Independence. Benjamin Rush was a smart guy. He was the renowned physician of the day. He concocted some of the most miserable medicine ever on the planet. In 1804, there was no surgery. There was no anesthesia. So Rush came up with a thing that was 40% mercury, and it was a purgative. And when you took this pill, you immediately threw up, and you also discharged from the other end. So Rush gave everybody these thunderbolts. He brought 1,000 of these with him because Rush said, this is it. You take these, this is going to cure anything. Rush not only gave people thunderbolts, he bled everybody. So he would cut a vein to let the toxins out of their body. And between cutting a vein and making these people weak from losing the blood and then throwing up and have explosive diarrhea, can you imagine what a day you would have? So anybody that got sick, that's what they got. So the men started not telling them they were sick. My guy, Silas Goodrich, he got bit on the finger by a beaver, and it got infected. And he treated it himself with gunpowder and whiskey. And he never told Clark, never told Lewis that he was sick. So after I was done with my tour, I was crazy enough to go to Montana and go through the White Cliffs with the Lewis and Clark people for 100 miles, and it was a lot easier going down versus fighting the current. Looking back, it was a neat trip. But at the time, I kept thinking I really didn't care if I was there or not. So I'm going to show Lewis and Clark's journey in about 10 minutes. I'm going to cover 8,000 miles, and I'm going to do it with his map behind me. And in the end, I'm going to read his obituary because he sounds almost like me. Here I go. What we've got here is Thomas Jefferson up in Monticello, who daily, for years, was concerned with what was all this purple stuff, which was west of the Mississippi. And he kept getting reports from people that there were dinosaurs out there, there were mountains made of salt, there were unicorns out there, and he knew better. And the people who were the biggest infractors, of course, were the trappers and the people who wrote stories. They were the worst because they would exaggerate things. And they would make up all this stuff, and none of it was out there. And he was real smart, Jefferson. He was the third president of the United States. He had the largest scientific library in the world, and he spoke five languages, and Lewis was his secretary. So he came up with a plan to con Congress into appropriating money for an exploration of the Northwest Passage, all the way to the Pacific Ocean. Now, why he was able to do this, because they didn't want to do it, you know, Congress. He bought all of this territory. He didn't tell them he was buying it. He bought it because once he bought it for the United States, then they were going to have to find out what they bought. And he bought 860,000 square miles of land. And he paid 3 cents an acre for this land. So it increased the holdings of the United States by a third. Now, he sent Lewis to get all this training, and then Lewis went to Pittsburgh to get a keelboat made and to get pirogues made for this journey that he was going to take into an unknown world. When he got to Pittsburgh, he thought that the keelboat would be done because they'd been working on it for quite a long time, and the people that were working on it were drunk, so they only finished half of it. So he was more than upset, and the reason being partly because he had to go down the Ohio River to the Mississippi, and every day the river was getting lower, and he would get stuck on sandbars, and he had to hire farmers with teams and with oxen to come and pull him off these sandbars. Then he hated it for many reasons, but one thing, Clark was waiting on him down there in Kentucky, and he didn't show up for like 2 weeks. And he says he was stuck all the time, and it was so bad he had to unload part of the cargo and hire people to haul that cargo down to Wheeling so that he could just get down the river. Once he got to Kentucky, Clark was there. He made Clark his captain, co-captain. The only problem with that being that Congress never approved of Clark being a captain. They wouldn't do that. He was a lieutenant in the Army, and they had no good reason. They did it anyway. So Lewis never told anybody that Clark was not a captain because it would have been a morale problem, partly. So Clark, while he was hanging out down there in Kentucky, waiting for Lewis to come along, he recruited 8 guys. 2 of them were Hull and Collins, those ruffians. These people they recruited, they were just used to hunting and running up and down the hills and chasing girls and stuff like that. Clark said, if you want to go on the most incredible adventure of your lifetime, then you go enlist in the military. The number one, the very first infantry. He conned those guys into, because he needed them. He needed more men to make this expedition. So he gets down to the Mississippi, and now this is the first time they're going to be going against a current. And it is bad. They make it up to St. Louis. That's their winter headquarters. They build a fort called Camp Du Bois, and they spend the whole winter training. And people, especially these guys from Kentucky, hated this regimentation that they had to go through, but they're now military, and they can't get out of it, because if they get out of it, they're deserters. So Collins and Hall screwed up. They went out and got drunk, came back, got court-martialed, got whipped. Again, that was their first time. So now, in the spring of May, 1804, they leave St. Louis, and they go all the way, Pasquaw Point, all the way, Floyd dies here, all the way to Mandan. They get to Mandan, and they've gone through like a dozen Native American tribes, because that's what their mission is, in addition to exploring, is to make friends with the Native American tribes. Well, in their entire course, they get hooked up with 50 different tribes. Most of them are friendly. Like the Yankton Sioux, they were friendly. We did a ceremony when I was with them, with the Yankton Sioux. They were wonderful. The only problem that Lewis and Clark got into, part of the problem was, in many instances, like with the Yanktons, when they left, they realized that the Yankton Sioux didn't understand a word of what they said, nor did they understand a word of what they said. So they were there on a mission to tell them that the great white father, Thomas Jefferson, was going to be taking over a lot of what they had now, and they didn't deliver this message because of a language barrier. So they stay in Mandan. They pick up an interpreter named Charbonneau. He's a French guy. He only basically speaks French. He is the worst guide and interpreter they could have ever gotten. The guy couldn't even swim, and he lived on the Missouri River. That's not good. So the cool part about Charbonneau is he was married to this woman right here, Sacagawea. Sacagawea was 16 years old. She was pregnant, and she's going to have a baby before they get out of there. And so she turns out to be the biggest asset of anything they have done, partly because she can speak five different Native American languages. So that's going to get them all the way to where they need to go with communication. Plus, since there's a woman with a baby, they're not a war party. So they scooted right through all these different Native American tribes without any fight at all. She taught them things like, you know, they're killing things every day, and they have to eat 6 or 8 pounds of meat every day because they work so hard. I mean, you think of how much that is for 40 men. That's a buffalo and a deer, or they got to eat, I got to catch 300 pounds of fish. And she teaches them that they can do things like eat berries and other things and killing everything all the time. Plus, think of the malnutrition of just eating meat for a year. It's kind of weird. So a lot of times the meat wasn't cooked very well because they'd be working all day, and then they'd get there at night And can you imagine trying to cook meat for 40 guys in the rain or when it's pitch black, dark, and you can't even tell what color it is, what you've brewed up. So they were sick a lot for all kinds of reasons, that being one of them. So Sacajawea, being a Shoshone, she had been kidnapped by the Hadasta when she was 11. Now she's 16, she has a baby, they're going, and they know they've got to do something about the mountains. They don't know how big they are, but they understand they're pretty big. And gets them to the Shoshone Nation camp, and when she gets them there, oh my God, her brother is the chief of the Shoshone Nation. So they have this unbelievable reunion after all this time her being gone, and she gets Lewis and Clark horses. Now they're going to use these horses to get over the mountains. They thought they could get over the mountains in about a day or two. It took 20 days. They ran out of food, of course. They started eating the horses. They'd eat anything. They would eat the bark off of the trees. They get over the mountains amazingly, and they stumble into the other side where the Nez Perce tribe lives. And they're dead. They're almost dead. So the Nez Perce people said, we're going to kill them, and we're going to take the horses, and we're going to have more rifles and stuff than anybody else around. So just when they're getting ready to kill them, there's this woman that's a Nez Perce woman, and she had been saved a long time ago by some white guy, and she talked the group into not killing them and, in fact, helping them. So they end up, Nez Perce helps them build dugouts, and for the first time now, they're going downstream. They're going down the Snake River. They're going down the Columbia River. And it was so treacherous going down these rivers. And by the way, dugouts are the most unstable things imaginable. And they're going down these rivers, and the Native Americans line up along the banks to watch them drown. Because there's no way in hell that they're going to get through lots of these chutes. Not going to make it.
They don't drown.
I mean, here they've gone through all this insanity, and they've gone down a river that nobody would go down in a dugout. A dugout weighs 200 pounds. The things are the most unstable things I've ever been in. They get to
the mouth of the Columbia River. They almost starve again because they ran out of food before they got there.
And once they got to the Columbia River, the weather was so bad they had to stay in the dugouts for 5 days and get beat to death by the rain and the cold. And finally, the weather cleared up and they started building a fort right close to the Pacific Ocean. And they built this fort, and they were going to spend their second winter there. And they had been told there would be ships come along with goods,
and they could get on these ships,
and they wouldn't have to go back the same way they came. Well, what happened was they missed the ship by a day, so they're going to have to go back the same way. So they get to, they build this fort, Fort Calsop. The elk, that's their only food source, and salmon. The elk are so skinny because they're starving that there's not hardly any meat on them, and every elk they killed had arrows in it. The Native Americans wanted the elk too, but they didn't bring them down with arrows. So they go to the ocean. They boil salt water to make salt, so they've got salt for the trip back so they can cure meat. And they get like 80 pounds of salt, and it took a long time to boil it. There was a dead whale out on the beach, so they ate part of that whale. And they were infested by fleas in the fort. And the fleas were so bad that it almost drove them crazy. There were thousands of fleas, and it rained every day but 10 in the 4 months that they were in Fort Calthrop. So they had one horrible time between the fleas, hardly no food, and everything else that happened. So they want to get out of there so bad that they leave early, which was a mistake, because once they go back up to the Nez Perce, the Nez Perce told them that they should not go across the mountains because they were going to freeze and they'd probably run out of food. They didn't pay any attention to them. They went across the mountains about halfway. They had to turn around and come back. Then they had to wait for a month until the snow subsided. Then they made it back. They can make it back over to the Shoshone Nation. Now they're for the first time going down the Missouri River with the current. They make dugout canoes and they travel sometimes 70 miles a day. They just paddle and paddle and paddle like maniacs. So they make it back to Mandan, and then they stay there for 3 days, and then they go all the way back at a record pace. Now, before, when they left Mandan, they had Corporal Worthington take the keelboat back with all of the things they'd collected. The prairie dog that they got when they were at Paw Point, all the journals that had been written. So he had a lot of responsibility, because if he screwed up and lost all that stuff, there wouldn't be anything to give Jefferson. So they buzzed right on back to St. Louis. And when they got there, nobody could believe they were alive. They hadn't heard anything from them in a year and a half. And so they bought them beers, and they listened to their stories. And it was cool for a long time. And the people that got paid was, of course, Clark and Lewis. They got 1,600 acres of land, and I can't remember how much money, but most of the other people, like the infantry, got $320. They didn't pay Sacagawea or York, the slave of Clark, anything. They got nothing for the trip. And all York wanted was his freedom. Clark wouldn't give him his freedom. He didn't give him his freedom for 5 years. And so same old disjointed type thing, you know, that hasn't changed much. But anyway, then Lewis, of course, was a basket case. The guy was a manic depressive. He took opium a lot. He had malaria. He drank a lot. And how in the hell could anybody direct this kind of an expedition and have all those conditions? He did it. He did it. So then Clark, he got to be the director of the Bureau of Indian Affairs. Jefferson gave Lewis some responsibility, and he never could do it, and he never could finish his journals, which was a big disappointment to the president. So I can't even imagine what it would have been like to have gone that far with all those horrible things, because I was just a big person that was complaining. And I was only around for a month. What do you think of that? What I'm going to do is a finale, is I'm going to take everybody with me on my Silas Goodrich catching a big fish trip. And when I put this hat on, which is an official replica of an official Lewis and Clark hat for the privates wore out in the field, and they would eat out of this hat sometimes. They would scoop up water to drink out of it sometimes. It would keep the sun and the hail and everything. It hailed a lot off of them. So it's not just some crazy hat that I've come up with. This is a regulation hat. I know that I'll look real nice in it. So this haversack, everybody had a haversack, partly because pockets hadn't been invented yet. There were no pockets in the uniforms. So they carried everything in this purse. I love this haversack. So when I take you back with me to this expedition, I want you to think that outside of this building, there are no modern conveniences. There's no computers, there's no cell phones, there's nothing out there. And all we're doing is we're going to be on the Missouri River and we're going to catch 150-pound catfish to help feed the men, because the men haven't had hardly anything to eat for 3 days. They've had some rabbits and a couple of dogs, and that's it. So my responsibility is to catch enough fish to feed them. I'm Silas Goodrich. I'm a soldier from Massachusetts with the Lewis and Clark Corps of Discovery. If there's one thing that I really like more than any, it's fishing. I love to catch fish. I love to eat them. I even love to clean them. I've been drinking the water out of that Missouri River ever since we left St. Louis, and it leaves a bad taste in my mouth. And even the whiskey that I get at the end of the day doesn't cut it. It tastes like you're eating bark. Last night it came a terrible storm. And the cottonwood tree right up in front of the keelboat got struck by lightning and actually set the top of it on fire. And this morning, it had rained so much that to walk, you've got to take your shoes off and you have to dig your toes in the mud or you're going to fall down. Now, I got up at dawn this morning because Captain Lewis asked me to catch some fish to help feed the men. And so I'm looking for a big catfish. And the big catfish swim along the edge of the river and feed early of a morning. So I noticed a swirl up in front of me, and that's usually a 100-pound fish or more that makes that kind of tail movement. And I'm going to try and catch this fish, and if I can, then that'll give us enough meat that at least a few people can eat. So I found this old dead bass on the bank this morning, and I'm going to see if that catfish will take it, but I doubt if he will, because most catfish, they're not going to eat something dead that's this rotten, but it's the only bait I got. So I'm going to move down toward a driftwood pile, which is where he went behind it. And then I'm going to throw this over the edge of the driftwood pile, and I'm going to see if he'll take it. And I'm going to know quickly if he's going to eat it, because they feel their bait with their whiskers, and I'll know I've got something going. So I'm throwing this over, and I'm going to wait just for a little bit. And I'm going to see if the line moves. The line's not moving. He's not going to bite it. I'm going to have to get around that driftwood pile, and I'm going to have to noodle this fish. And I don't like that, because noodling a fish that big, he can take you right out into the current, into the Missouri River. He can drown you. But I got no choice. because Clark and Lewis want somebody to supply some food. I ease around the driftwood pile, and I start putting my hand in the mud bank holes,
and I'm trying to see if I can feel
the catfish. And when I get around to the second mud bank hole, I feel him. His mouth is moving up and down. And I put my fingers in his mouth. And then I ease my whole hand in his mouth. And now I'm going to try and pull him out. And if I can get him out of that hole, then I'm going to try and get him up on the bank. I get him out of that hole, and I drag him out, and he takes me almost out into the current, and I bring him this way, and I'm pulling him up toward the keelboat, and Clark sees me, and he says, "Good job, Goodrich." And I wave to him, and now the men see me, and they're so happy, and they start clapping. You'd think I'd struck gold. I get this big cat up to the keelboat, and Shields, our blacksmith, helps me get him up on the boat. And Shields has built a fire pit up in the front of the keelboat, and we clean this fish, and we start cutting him up, and we start cooking him, and we start throwing pieces of meat out to the guys that are help pull the keelboat and to the guys that are paddling. And we get up to where
I see up in front of us a dead horse
hanging in the tree. The hunters have killed a horse, and we're going to drag him off onto the keelboat, and we're going to cut him up, and we're going to cook him too. So we get about 5 miles up the river, and people have had a little bit of food now, and they're not quite as grumbly. And I crawl up onto the second deck of the keelboat, and Seaman, Lewis's big Newfoundland dog, is up there. And I look down at him into his big, brown, beautiful eyes. And I say, "Tomorrow we get to do this all over again." I was a lot younger then. I'm a lot older now. But that was one of the greatest fishing trips of my life, even though there were hardships. And in closing, I'm going to read a piece of the obituary of Silas Goodrich. It says, "Silas, when he was but 9 years old, in childhood, youth, and manhood." When Silas was a young man, he secured the affection and respect of all those who knew him. As a neighbor, he was so peaceable, kind, and respectful that he made many friends and no enemies. And I thought, he was just like me. That's all I know. Thank you, everybody. If you have any questions, I'll try to answer them, or I'll just make stuff up.